el-Rufai and not the Miss the Crown. His compact size is in inverse proportion to the immensity of his many talents and the forever presence of his charm. You can hardly meet a more self-assured man, a person who values the life of the mind, invests in its cultivation, and repeatedly stands out for his application of intellect and logic. He has been described as one of the most educated and able Nigerian in any field, and certainly one of the very best to have held public office, one of the most committed to public good. Nasir El-Rufai's talents are strengthened by a tough character built on the old values that are anchored on hard work, integrity, and resilience. This awesome talent was nurtured from this very land, and he has devoted himself to public service to make it a better place for all. Nasir El-Rufai was born to Mallam Nasir Ahmad, a native of Zaria, who was then living in rural Dodawa in 1960, the year of independence. After completing primary school in Kaduna, his mind was sharpened at Barewa College and further refined at the Mallam University of Zaria, where he graduated in first class honors in quantity surveying. In 1982, shortly after his return to Kaduna, following his NYC in Abeokuta, he founded El-Rufai Partners, a former quantity surveying consultancy firm, and he came into prominence as a leader in his professional field, while also investing in the future of young people by teaching part-time in ABU, his alma mater. Not only did he run a successful business, El-Rufai also acquired an MBA and sufficient training in computer science to ginger him to becoming one of the first investors in the internet service provision sector in Nigeria. He made friends across the country who admired him for his strength of character, integrity, and compassion. The sheer breadth of El-Rufai's knowledge, his broad mind, the clarity of his analysis, and his competence soon brought him to the attention of General Abdulsalam Abubakar, who in 1998 appointed him to the Policy Implementation and Monitoring Committee, PIMCO, which was charged to help manage the transition program that led to the handover of the democratically elected government in 1999. In that capacity, he interfaced with World Bank, the IMF, and other agencies, and helped draft the legislation that established the Bureau of Public Enterprises, BPE. Little did he know that it would be his lot to one day lead the PBE. But the same qualities that have brought him to limelight also impressed President Shehu Obasanjo, who charged him in 1999 to run the privatization program as Director General of the BPE. Mallam Nasir El-Rufai distinguished himself at the BPE, showcasing a clear-headedness, tenacity, and courage that persuaded President Obasanjo to saddle him in 2003 with the difficult job of managing Abuja as the Minister of the Federal Capital Authority. The compact Mallam did not disappoint as he tackled that giant challenge. He restored Abuja to the dream of its founder, gave Nigeria its first computerized land registry, and made it possible for ordinary Nigerians, 27,000 of them, to own land in Abuja, once they followed simple but clear procedures. Many more were to benefit from his supervision of the sale of government properties following the adoption of the monetization policy by the federal government. El-Rufai became known as a successful manager of difficult tasks. By handling all with aplomb, he initiated the process of pension reforms that bettered the new contributory pension scheme, led the planning team for a new national identity mechanism, and coordinated the Bureau of Public Service Reforms. During his service as FCT Minister, he invited and provided facilities for the EFCC to set up a unit in his ministry, in a firm demonstration of his commitment to transparency. After 9 years in public office, El-Rufai returned to school, completing a law degree and enrolling for a master's in public administration at the Kennedy School of Government, Harvard University. Since his return to the country, he has been active as a vocal public intellectual and has maintained a popular weekly column. El-Rufai chaired the renewal committee of the CPC, and he was a signatory of the APC's island registration form that confirmed the merger of the five parties that fused into the APC. He was later appointed the interim deputy national secretary of the APC. In April 2015, Mallam Nasir Ahmad El-Rufai was elected governor of Kaduna State on the platform of the APC. In that case, he has brought zeal, innovation, and results to governance. Accord on the restoration program, the manifesto of the Kaduna APC, he is leading a team to remake governance in the state and align all priorities to the sustainable delivery of public goods. He has scored many firsts. Among all the unique steps, he is the first to attack portfolios while sending his cabinet nominations for confirmation, and is the first to implement the Treasury single account. Under his leadership, Kaduna State has doubled its internally generated revenues, attained unprecedented levels of capital spending, and secured significant levels of foreign direct investments. In 2017, Mallam El-Rufai began implementing measures to reform the public service and improve standards in the education sector by disengaging 21,780 failed primary school teachers and recruiting 25,000 new teachers to replace them. He has established Kaduna Geographic Information Service as a new digital land registry for the state. Centralized revenue collection in the new Kaduna State Internal Revenue Service through a new tax law and placed pension management under one pension bureau. His government has completed and commissioned a 150 million liters per day water treatment plant component of the Zaria Water Project, and is profiting 12 water works across the state. The El-Rufai government has prioritized infrastructure development in mid-2017. It had 443 kilometers of township roads and 16 intercity roads with a distance of 414.8 kilometers at various stages of completion. There have been schools being rebuilt, while it is upgrading 255 hospitals to be equipped with tools for safer deliveries and management of infant and maternal health. Mallam Nasir El-Rufai is a resolute champion of the equality of opportunity. He recently chaired the APC Committee on True Federalism, which has recommended the devolution of powers, including policing and control mineral resources to the states. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, join me welcome our dear guest, special guest lecturer, Mallam Nasir Ahmad el-Rufai, Executive Governor of Kaduna State.
We can destroy everything. It's not going to be good. It's not going to be good.
Your Excellency, the Governor of Ondo State, my brother, Governor of the Director of the SAM. Store Chancellor and members of the Council of the University of Medical Sciences, Ondo. Your Royal Highness, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, it was very humbling for me standing before you to hear this citation. Sometimes when you hear this citation, you wonder whether you are talking about someone else. But I would like to talk to this citation so that I give my wife to have to see how others see me. I'm very grateful. And let me start, English ladies and gentlemen, with my profound apologies for once rescheduling this lecture, which was supposed to have had this some weeks back, and then arriving late today. As they say in the aviation sector, this is due to technical reasons, because schedule conflict, something came up, so I had to ask the Vice Chancellor to please give another day. And the second, we arrived late here due to the late arrival of the British Army. It is good to be here. My friend and brother, Governor Rotimi, I carried to the SAM, with whom I share a long history. Solidarity, professional and political engagement. When I was exiled by the Eredu administration, the chief wrote to me at Eredu and his partner, where I commissioned him, where my lawyers, many times because of my defense, at the time when speaking against the government, but that's why he's here in the governor of Ondo State. I'm grateful. Many people don't know this, but our history goes back many, many years. I want to thank Your Excellency for inviting me and hosting me here in Ondo State. It is a great privilege to be in this specialized University of Medical Sciences. Model that we are studying to replicate in Kaduna State by God's grace. The event has been. We are also keen students of Ondo State's achievements, not only in tertiary education, but in delivering quality primary health care to the poorest citizens, and are also shamelessly copying same in Kaduna State. I therefore thank the Pro Chancellor, Council and Management of the University for inviting me. I was particularly delighted when I got the invitation to deliver this fourth distinguished guest lecture of the University for two reasons. First, I am persuaded that the development prospects of any country are connected to how well educated its citizens are. Secondly, I also believe
that fundamental reforms in education are crucial to guarantee equal opportunity for all citizens, regardless of their economic or social status. Education is a lever for social mobility, enabling people to rise above the circumstances of their birth and providing a means for building a meritocratic society. We have begun implementing ambitious education reforms in Kaduna State. And as you all know, these reforms have very often been met with resistance, or in some cases, misrepresentation and mischief. Your invitation seems to me to be another acknowledgement that the rest of Nigeria, particularly my colleagues, state governors, are watching closely how Kaduna State is pursuing the reforms in education, and how we are overcoming the resistance of those who think that their privileges, parasites, and entitlements should come before they need to equip the next generation with the ability to compete in a world that is changing faster than we can compete. I will ground the Kaduna State government views on education reforms on the practical realities we need in Kaduna State, and what we are doing to change those realities from dryness to a positive one for all our children. Now, I'll start with a bit of history, because the title of this lecture is looking back and looking forward. So before I look forward, let me look back to history. This is important because many of the young people here did not study history. So a word or two about the historical context of education in Nigeria is appropriate to help build the picture, the evolution, the formation and challenges of education in Nigeria. As I noted in an article I wrote that was published on the back page of this day and online by Sahara Reporters and Nigeria Village Square on 29 July 2011, about 7 years ago, the title of the article was Why Education Cannot Wait. Nigeria has neither sustained the government investment in education nor maintained standards. At independence, Nigeria's 56 million people had 15,703 primary schools and a total enrollment of about 2.9 million pupils all across the country. We had 883 secondary schools at independence, 2 federal government colleges, 315 teacher training colleges, and 29 technical and vocational schools, all with a total enrollment of 169,000 students. We had only one university college at Ibadan. By the time we became a republic in 1963, we had 4 polytechnics and 5 universities, with a total of 2,445 undergraduate students. Kaduna State alone today has about 2 million pupils in public primary schools, compared to the nearly 3 million that were attending primary schools in the whole of Nigeria in 1960. So it has been a major jump in quantity. The then regional governments invested heavily in education. At that time, Nigeria as a whole allocated and spent an average of 40% of a national budget on education, compared to about 2% under 20% governments like Babangida administration, 50% of education. The old Western region under Chief Obatike Awolowo's visionary leadership devoted 55% of its budget on education. At the same time, the Northern Regional Government under an equally committed leadership of Samuel Bello, Mr. Donald Sokoko, he amassed about 46% of his regional budget on education. However, since the 1960s, the numbers of Nigerians in schools has increased, but the levels of investment and budgetary spending have not kept pace. The Universal Primary Education Program introduced in the 1970s tried to manage the explosion in demand for schooling by expanding access to teacher training colleges to train primary school teachers. Legislation on universal basic education commits all state governments to deliver 9 years of free basic education. Yet, there are still many children out of school in parts of the country, particularly in northern Nigeria. But the reality is that despite the massive increase in the number of educational institutions at all levels, standards have fallen. And many employers have come to regard increased expenditure on training entry-level staff to their own standards as another unavoidable cost of doing business in Nigeria. But there is no reason why the dissonance between numbers and quality should persist. It is perverse that in Nigeria we have an inverse relationship between the number of people going to school and the quality of the product. If we desire progressive outcomes for all our people, we cannot allow this series of tests to persist. We must be able to educate every Nigerian to globally competitive standards. I will now begin the discussion of education in Kaduna by quickly stating that Kaduna State is 12th overall in WAEC scores nationally, but number one among all the 19 northern states. Anyone familiar with the reality of education in Nigeria will know that even first position nationally is precarious, not to mention poor. We have work to do to expand access to education and to achieve vastly improved standards. But what is our government's agenda? In 2014, we in the APC began campaigning for the responsibility to lead Kaduna State. We developed and presented to our people what we call the restoration program, as the Kaduna State specific iteration of the APC manifesto. After analyzing the dismal state into which over 1.5 decades of PDP misrule has plunged the state, we decided to inspire in our people a firm belief in a better future through the rallying cry. Our campaign slogan was, "Let's make Kaduna great again. We believe Donald Trump stole it from us." At the core of the restoration program is the fundamental belief in equality of opportunity, that once given the basic tools by government, people can maximize their potential to build a good life for themselves. As I noted in the preface to the manifesto, and I quote, "The APC believes that every citizen has the right to live in dignity, to aspire to and attain a good life. That it is the duty of the government to organize society to enable every person to develop their talents and be educated and healthy enough to make the best choices for themselves." End of quote. Therefore, the development of human capital is number one of the 5 priority areas we identified in the restoration program, and we promise to invest aggressively in education, healthcare, and social welfare. The rationale for this policy choice is obvious. We recognize education as a fundamental component of human development. Education is an aspirational asset, a tool that sparks the curiosity to seek solutions. This curiosity and its resultant solutions are integral, providing the kind of answers we need for progress and modern development. Perhaps the most important of its many benefits is the opportunity for social mobility. How quality education enables the poor to move out of poverty by the sheer force of determination, application of knowledge and hard work. Within a generation, education can transform a poor family to a middle class family. And only education can do that. And this assertion that education enhances life chances is not some motivational balderdash. It is the lived reality of many of us who were nurtured in a different Nigeria. As the orator said, I started life in rural Dawdawa, Kaduna State, as the son of a pensioner. After my father's death, I was moved to Kaduna to live with my uncle, where I completed primary education at the local education authority primary school, Kao. In 1972, I proceeded to Barewa College, Zaria, for my secondary education, another government school. The foundation my teachers gave me in primary school was further reinforced in Barewa College. The commitment of these teachers to knowledge and hard work nurtured the drive and study habits that enabled me to study diligently in a much better university to earn a degree in quantitative surveying in 1980. It is a fact that I and many people of my generation not a good school without the availability of free public education. The quality of education will see then a contrast in the skills required to compete with our peers anywhere in the world. Having been so blessed to receive decent and mostly free public education and to be given the opportunity to improve our status, I'm the second person in my family to get a university degree. Do we not then have a moral burden to ensure that today's children enjoy what we got? Should today's parents have to pay through their noses to secure for their children decent education in primary and secondary schools, something that we got from government schools? This is why the current Kaduna State government is committed to improve the infrastructure and tools that make education more conducive for teachers and students, because a good foundation is crucial to any future learning process. And we are determined as a state government to make the necessary investments to attract and retain the best people in character, skill, and learning in the teaching profession. Now I will describe briefly how we made education in Kaduna State in 2015. During our campaign in the 2014-15 election cycle, the ABC drew attention of the people of Kaduna State to the poor condition of the over 4,250 public primary schools in the state, many large rooms, doors or windows. The absence of water and toilets made sanitation a tall drink in many of our schools. In some places, the school was just some available open space. We argued then that our children deserve better, and we promised that if elected, we would make it happen. Today, if resource transfer maintains the pace of change. For the record, I have reproduced in my paper, I will go through it in detail, what the exact commitments we made in our manifesto on education. We made 11 commitments, and I will list all of them. But I'll start with the preamble. Our educational policies and programs are aimed at eradicating illiteracy in communities, ensuring that every child gets at least 9 years of free basic education, improving infrastructure and tools, while attracting the best people in character and learning to the teaching profession. So that's the basic policy. We therefore committed to, one, fully implement and enforce the universal basic education act with specific emphasis on tuition-free, compulsory basic education for every child living in the community. Two, enhance the pay and reward system for teachers, train and improve their competence, along with vigorous inspection and enforcement of performance standards. Three, build and improve more libraries in schools and community centers. Four, develop and promote effective use of innovative teaching methods and materials in primary and secondary schools using the latest technology. Five, expanding and improving education opportunities for the most vulnerable, hard-to-reach and disadvantaged children, particularly girls. Seven, facilitate tooling and skills transfer programs for unemployed youth to make them self-employed. Eight, ensure the full optimization of the capacity of existing technical and commercial colleges and expand widely. Nine, revive and expand all vocational centers for technical skills acquisition, including addressing needs of physically challenged who require special education. Ten. Guarantee that the existing senior secondary and tertiary institutions will receive the required attention in terms of funding and learning environment. And 11, ensure conducive policies and regulatory framework that will strengthen the existing private educational institutions in community. And finally, on the 10th, a situation assessment of the Kaduna scholarship scheme with a view to increasing expenditure on science and technology programs at master's and doctoral levels. As soon as we won the elections, we set up a transition committee to work out a detailed rollout of these programs to attain our government goals and continue our campaign promises. In that transition period, we received a report from the Education Sector Support Program in Nigeria, ESPE, a different program funded by the UK government, on the competency levels of our primary school teachers and pupils. That was our first shock. The ESPEN 2014 report, which made scary reading, revealed among others that, one, 83% of all teachers in our primary school had a proficiency in mathematics and literacy of below 25%. Secondly, primary two pupils in Kaduna State had an average score of 14% in English and 27% in math. Thirdly, primary four pupils had an average score of 13% in English and 17% in numeracy. That was the first shock we had that we are going to be facing very serious problems. We know things were bad, but we didn't figure this bad. So these were indicators that there was little difference in educational standards between the teachers and the pupils. In the course of the sectoral meetings to which we devoted our first week in office, we are told that at least 50% of our pupils in primary schools sit on bare floors due to lack of school furniture in the dilapidated classrooms that we observed while campaigning. Therefore, we knew we had to address teacher standards and the learning environment if we were to make any progress towards achieving our policy goal of expanding access to decent education for the children of the poorest people in our state. So what did we do to confront the problem? As a government, the problems we have been complaining about in opposition became our responsibility to fix. In 2015, we declared a state of emergency in education, enabling us to accelerate procurement and payment procedures for educational projects, and began a program of renovation and rehabilitation of primary schools. This included providing roofs, windows, doors, boreholes, and toilets. While urgently needed, we built new classrooms. In addition, we began placing orders for school furniture because in some places, up to 90% of the pupils, not the 50% the former government told us, had no desks or chairs. Up to 90% were sitting on floors. After spending about 6 billion fixing about 10% of our primary schools, we did an evaluation that concluded that we need to move towards rebuilding schools, not just renovating them. Because in some of the classrooms, we have 200 pupils in a class, which means we need to build 4 more classrooms, because our target was 40 pupils per class. With a growing population, our primary schools need to have more classrooms and offices for teachers. We therefore opted to begin to build schools on 2 or 3 floors, depending on the projected demand and availability of land. And we concluded that we would require system-building technologies and significant sources of funding to rebuild schools in the time that we prefer, because we have 4-year election cycles, so we have maximum of 4 years, maybe a minimum of 4 years, maximum of 8 years, to try to build 4,000 schools. So if we're going to be building this school, they're putting a block on each block, it will take us 20 years. So we have to find those that are usually prefabricated buildings using precast concrete so that we can put up a classroom in 3 weeks rather than 3 months. And we have a couple of companies that have located the new. We were convinced that we had to open up to the federal government and our development partners about the scale of the challenges we face on the education front. Because if we spend 6 billion to renovate 10% of the schools, it means that we need 60 billion to represent 100% of the schools. Now 60 billion, when your monthly allocation is 4 to 5 billion, will take forever. So we realized that we needed to get a huge injection of money from somewhere we didn't know where. And we started looking for help. We went to the federal government and other development partners, which I will give some details. So what we did was we compiled an album showing pictures of our schools and how run down they were. We also took statistics of our pupil teacher ratios. And I shared the album with the Minister of Finance, Kemi Adeokun, and then our development partners, including the Abuja office of the World Bank. This is what led to the discussions that culminated in the World Bank approving a concessionary performance for results credit facility of $350 million for Kaduna State on 20th June 2017. Now, this is a concessionary facility because the interest rate is less than 1%. There is a 10-year moratorium in which you pay nothing, and then 14 years to pay. So it's almost free. So we built this facility, which would have enabled us to take care of the physical infrastructure of component of the primary education challenge, in respect to other investments that will transform the economy of Kaduna State. Unfortunately, the enemies of the ordinary people in Kaduna State and the Nigerian Senate continue to be a stumbling block to access the facility. Don't keep trying. Who knows? They can be born again. But we remain keen about addressing the personnel side too. Because we have competent teachers, even the most glittering school is as lifeless as a graveyard. But great teachers can inspire their pupils even when conditions are not so ideal. Government therefore responded to the implications of the 2014 SP report by getting first the National Open University of Nigeria to conduct a survey of teacher competence. We took further steps to address gaps by arranging training and retraining for the teachers as follows during the 2016-2017 session. 11,315 classroom teachers were trained in literacy and numeracy through our State Universal Basic Education Board. Another 3,733 teachers were trained in reading skills using funds from Global Partnership for Education. Universal Basic Education Commission also trained a further 5,945 teachers in pedagogy, lesson plans, and use of teachers' guides. So we invested in training. Over 1.6 billion naira was spent in the 3 years to train the teachers that we found. On 3rd June 2017, the Kaduna State government conducted a competency test for primary school teachers. The test was organized and supervised by a committee, which included the state chairman and secretary of the Nigerian Union of Teachers and representatives of the Teacher Registration Council of Nigeria as members. The test assessed the numeracy and literacy levels of the teachers through a primary four equivalent test. The government considered that giving teachers a 75% pass threshold for the primary four test was an extremely generous decision. Indeed, when we debated in the Executive Council, I was pushing for 90%, but some of the council members pushed for 70 and we finally settled at 80. But the results were disappointing. Only 11,591 teachers, or about 33%, scored at least 75% in the test. Others fell within the following categories: 17 to 74, 5,766, about 17%. 60 to 69, about 8,759, about 26%. 0 to 29, did you think some scored 0? 8,047. 23.58%. We therefore made the painful but necessary decision to disengage teachers that scored less than 75%. This was done in accordance with the terms of their employment. So those teachers that have put in enough years of service to retire were retired and they moved into the pension system, while those that did not qualify would maintain their severance and they go. Government records indicated that concerns about the problem of teacher quality led the government of late Rapatija Power in 2012 to dismiss about 4,000 teachers found to have fake paper qualifications. That same year, the Akua government also gave the other teachers with inadequate qualifications a 5-year window within which they should acquire the Nigerian Certificate of Education, the NCE, which is the minimum teaching qualification in Nigeria. This 5-year window expired in 2017. And this is the reason why we timed the teacher competency test in 2017. Why would it have been more popular and politically expedient to retain these unqualified teachers? We chose not to perpetuate the unfortunate cycle of mediocrity. We decided that the future of nearly 2 million pupils in our public primary schools mattered above all other considerations. After spending over a billion naira on teacher training, we asked those who said we should give the paid teachers more time whether it is fair to subject the future prospects of endless cohorts of our children to teachers who are not significantly better than their pupils. The future of how many more of our children should be sacrificed for politics and political expedience. We decided that this must stop at all costs. Despite the threats of organized labor and the strike action that followed, we launched a program to recruit 25,000 new teachers and disengage 21,780. More than 43,000 applied for teaching positions all across Nigeria. After examinations, our Universal Basic Education Board arrived at a shortlist of 15,897, which list was subjected to further face-to-face scrutiny of certificates and verbal interviews and essay writing. I'm happy to disclose that by the time we did that, we have hired the first batch of 11,385 new teachers. They have completed their induction training and have now reported in the schools to which they are posted. About 3,000 to 4,000 of those that purportedly passed the exam and went through the process of certification, some of them could not write a letter of acceptance. So you are giving your letter, this is your letter of employment to write your acceptance. Some of them are opening their phone and copy. So many of these we put aside because you know how the system is. Some will manage to smuggle themselves in. Immediately after the process, we had to disengage all our education secretaries and all the 23 local governments, because we found that they incited this opportunity, so they never even sat the exam. So we fired all of them, and we are in the process of hiring new education secretaries because of their involvement in this process. It is a very difficult system, the systemic, and everyone is trying to put his relation or his friend. Meanwhile, all their children are in private schools. So they don't care what they send to public schools. But we care, and I will explain why. So we intend to continue to recruit teachers until we meet the target of 25,000 new teachers to replace the 21,718.5 teachers that were disengaged. Processing of the second batch of teacher recruitment are about to begin. Our Universal Basic Education Board already has over 19,000 applications, so with some luck, we'll be able to get the balance. As I said, we'll take only those teachers that meet our standards. Now, because of this disengagement of teachers, as soon as all the teachers are in place, we intend to extend our school hours by one hour every day, and we'll have full classes on Saturdays to be able to catch up before the close of this academic session sometime in June. So reforming education is a multi-dimensional undertaking aimed at producing young people who are knowledgeable, curious, creative, and imaginative. Young people with the ability to question and make things better, imbued with the necessary attribute of mind and the character to be productive and ethical. The teacher is at the core of education, with the outcomes of the learning process so dependent on the teacher's knowledge, dedication, and ability to inspire the students. There are also issues about the learning environment, the physical infrastructure, the curriculum, and the instructional materials. And in a country where even teachers in public schools often place their own children in private schools, it is important to involve the communities in implementing and monitoring reforms at the local level. I will now proceed to describe the various angles of our education reform process. First, the first is free education. As soon as we came into office, we made basic education, 9 years basic education, fully free in Kaduna State. By making primary and junior secondary education fully free and outlawing the collection of any hidden fees and levies. So in Kaduna State, no headmaster or principal collects PTA fees. If he does, he loses his job. No fees at all. You are not allowed to collect a penny from parents. So any by taking this decision, ladies and gentlemen, we have saved parents in Kaduna State about 3.4 billion naira every year since September 2015, when we brought in the policy. So this is money that goes back to their pocket that they can do something else that they were paying before. The second is empowering teachers. The community state government has taken several decisions to empower teachers in recognition of their centrality to positive outcomes in education. Fundamental to this is the rejection of the disparaging notion that teaching should be a profession of last resort, jobs for the hunger strong, and political jobs that help certain politicians in power. For that is how persons with disability education were employed as teachers. We are restoring the professional pride of the teacher in several ways. First,
In 2015,
we removed the career barrier that prevented teachers from reaching the permanent secretary grade. Teachers in Kaduna State can reach graduate and retain the highest pay grade in the public service without having to stop being classroom teachers, headmasters, or principals. Number two, salaries. Our state executive council has taken a decision to pay teachers at least 27.5% more than other public servants. This is an effort to ensure that the profession and remuneration are attractive and competitive enough to attract the brightest candidates. While the framework for this increment is being worked out by the Office of the Head of Service, Accountant General and Minister of Finance, we took the decision to waive personal income tax deductions on teachers' current pay. So teachers in Kaduna State don't pay tax now. Now, when the new salary scale is in place, they will start paying tax. But for now, they don't pay. Thirdly, training. We expect forward from our teachers. This imposes on the government a duty to provide platforms for the teachers to continuously update their knowledge and teaching skills. Such a platform also makes it possible to create a regular assessment of the government's teaching and to respond promptly with the appropriate training package. Through continuous training, teaching capacity will be enhanced, and there may be no need in the future for the drastic actions of removing paid teachers because they will not exist. The Kaduna State University has complied with my directive to establish an institute of education to handle this very important continuous training function. Number four, teachers' welfare. Apart from salary issues, we are taking the decision to provide free housing for teachers deployed to rural areas. This is a long-term undertaking. To remove one of the major reasons why teachers shun postings to have to reach areas. The designs for these teachers' quarters are ready and we start constructing them across all the 23 local governments in the state. We have also recently issued free motorcycles to some rural head teachers to ease their transportation. Number five, upgrading the entry criteria. We must raise the intellectual level of our teachers. We recognize that the Nigerian Certificate of Education is the current minimum teaching qualification. One of our goals is ultimately to have only graduates as teachers in our primary schools. We strongly believe that the NCE should give way eventually first and second degrees as minimum teaching qualifications in our public schools. Now, in terms of educational attainment worldwide, it is not UK or America that is ranked the best in terms of education. It is Finland. And in Finland, before you qualify to apply to be a teacher, you must have at least a master's degree. Mm-hmm. That's why we want to take the university and go through. Then continuous improvement. We must continue to recruit teachers so that we do not create gaps because people die, they retire, they are dismissed. We must continuously recruit teachers, not just doing us and what it meant. Then we have volunteer teaching skills. One of the key lessons we learned from our current reform effort is that as long as we implement the reforms in the best interest of the people, you will get public support once the reforms are explained and understood. As a consequence of our reforms and the increased awareness of the potential benefit to our pupils and students, we have received unsolicited offers from citizens to serve as volunteer teachers. We are grateful for this expression of civic enthusiasm, and the government is currently working out the mechanism to properly engage interested persons in the volunteer teacher scheme. We are working on physical infrastructure to improve the learning environment and build and expand schools, construct teachers' quarters, to provide clean furniture and sanitation, especially water and toilets. This is no small matter, as the case of one primary school in the Gasa ward in the local government that has some 26,000 students in one primary school, just one school. We have had to erect tents, because there are only 14 classrooms in that school. So if you do the math, you understand the level of congestion. So we had to erect tents, while we need two more schools to congest this school. Then there is the issue of technology in life. We are piloting the use of computer tablets for instruction in some of our secondary schools. We have distributed some 15,000 tablets to students starting with girls' secondary schools. And here I want to acknowledge the support of ExxonMobil Energy Student Venture that kindly donated 5,000 of such tablets. The state has provided training on ICT usage to the teachers in these schools and we have provided laptops to those certified. The ultimate aim of this is to test the effectiveness of using tablets. Now in these tablets you have the entire syllabus for work and therefore you have all the textbooks, you have past question papers and solutions. And we want to use them in some schools for the next 3 years and then compare with other schools that don't have them and see whether there's a significant difference in performance. And then we start looking for the money to deploy tablets all across the school. So we thought we should start with a pilot. We are also replacing blackboards in our primary school with whiteboards, and instead of chalk, we are using pens. We also started this primary school civic program in Kaduna State. We fed 1.5 million primary pupils every school day. And I think to add that the federal government has now taken over a significant component of this responsibility under its social investment program, and the program continues. We've also enhanced the quality of feeding in boarding secondary schools, and we've outsourced the feeding to patrons rather than principal buying fried, you know, tomatoes and cooking, and diverting some of the money to supporting. Finally, the provision of school uniforms. The government further provided free school uniforms to secondary school students as a further step to alleviate the burden on parents and reduce the barriers or excuses keeping the children out of school. Our government has also enacted the law establishing school management boards and school-based management committees in each of our nearly 5,000 schools. The purpose of this law is to ensure community involvement in school governance and improve accountability in how budget for each school is spent. So we send the overhead to each school direct to its account, and the school management board and the school management committees monitor how the principal or headmaster use these funds. And in the school management committees, we have religious leaders, traditional leaders, and other community leaders as members to put an eye on the principal and the headmaster. We have also introduced the policy of compulsory enrollment of public servants, children of public servants in public schools. We are designing to teach public education and raise the standards such that private education will only become a luxury and not a necessity for proper education. As we make progress in implementing this, we are going to require all our senior officials. By senior officials, I mean assistant director and above, to enroll their children in public schools. This gives them a stake in ensuring that the process continues to be intensive and qualitative. I have already made a pledge to enroll my eligible son in a public school when he turns 16 in 2019. So how do you prepare the children of the year for the future? I'm now coming to the future. As noted earlier, the world is changing at an unprecedented pace. Technology is disrupting all sciences and opening new business. Nigeria has to embrace the challenge of preparing our children for this new world. Our curriculum must evolve, and our pedagogy must begin to prioritize teaching children how to think. We must banish crime and road signs, and encourage everyone to put knowledge at the goal of education, not certificate. I warn you because many young people in Nigeria believe that acquiring a certificate is equivalent to acquiring an education. It is not. You can buy a certificate. You can sleep your way through getting a certificate, but it doesn't put knowledge in your head. So much energy is put into acquiring certificates that so little knowledge actually sinks in. And this must change if we are to survive in the 21st century. The impact of ICT in learning is broadening by the day. Many are the subjects now available online from reputable sources like Khan Academy that teaches mathematics. Even the Ivy League universities, Harvard, MIT and so on, offer free courses online that you can take and you can get certified. So the question that we need to ask ourselves, that with the acceleration of this ICT learning platform, does it mean that in many properly networked environments, we do not need bricks and mortar schools? Do we really need classrooms? Do we need environments like this to impart knowledge? Because most of the world is going virtual and going online. There is so much knowledge online that only the lazy can say he doesn't know anything. Anything you don't know, you can ask Google. And in seconds, you have the answer. And Nigeria has the highest penetration of smartphones of any country in Africa, and growing very fast. So instead of using this for Facebook and Instagram, use more Google and Wikipedia, you may learn a few things or two. So the acceleration of this ICT platform, as I said, may soon mean many properly networked environments might not need brick and mortar schools, except for reasons of socializing the students into community ethos and building relationship among them. So that has value, interaction has value. That's why people say he went to the university, but the university didn't go to him. When you see someone with a university degree, but behaving like a postman, they say he went to the university, but he didn't go to him. So the socialization aspect is important, but I'm sure in time, this technology will solve that. In addition to acknowledging ICT, we should consider whether instruction in our local languages might be helpful in attaining better learning outcomes at any stage of education. After all, the Russians, the Japanese, and the Chinese have not needed English, master technology, or send courses into space. These are some of the most successful countries today, and they teach in their own language. In this regard, and this is my point really, our national policy on education, which was drafted in the 1970s and introduced in the 1980s, is overdue for holistic review. I want to add here that Kaduna State is already working on its own state educational policy that will prepare our citizens for the 21st century, because within the current national policy, that's not. So let me conclude so that I give you time to question you. By saying that the reason for all our actions are the nearly 2 million pupils in public primary schools in Kaduna State, who are mostly children of the poor, and who constitute the future generations of our state. And we have a choice. We can either educate them and empower them, or they become the future recruits of Boko Haram and other insurgent organizations. Now, to equip these children with the requisite skills and knowledge to build a better future and compete nationally and globally, we must ensure that they have the best educational foundation, which is primary and secondary education. If there is one thing I wish to strongly underline in this lecture, let it be that investing in young people today means we are positively transforming our societies for tomorrow. This is what we are striving for in Kaduna State. And we know that with our current reforms and the support we are getting from within the state, Nigeria and abroad will achieve this. The education budget in Kaduna State under our watch has moved from less than 10% of the state budget and has averaged between 31 and 35% from 2016. We are not going to keep our orders 55%. Most are much better to 46% than we are on the way there. This is way above the UN minimum of 26%. Although we have raised enrollment in public primary schools from 1.1 million in July 2015 when we took over to about 2 million by September 2017, we have a long way to go to complete the upgrade of schools and other aspects. But at least we know there is a problem in education in Kaduna State, and we have the courage to do something about it. There is no point in conceding a sore when transparency could help you cure it and prevent a future cancer. That is why we had absolutely no problem sharing the album of our dilapidated schools with the Federal Minister of Finance and the World Bank, so that the scale of our problem could be appreciated. And I want to appreciate the Minister of Finance and the World Bank Managing Director for appreciating this and giving them the support. Some newspapers make a regular sport of publishing front page pictures of our school children sitting on floors, here. But it is a problem that we had and have openly acknowledged since 2015. And the point is that we're doing something about it. The problem that was born and festered for 16 years cannot be totally solved in 3 years. I must at this point acknowledge the strong editorial support many in the media have given to our top decisions to reform education and their support for the disengagement of the unqualified teachers. And we would not be deterred by the predictable resistance to education reform. Reform is not easy. Reform is resisted even by those who benefit. Recall what Machiavelli wrote about 500 years ago, that when you want to change things for the better, those that are going to benefit are silent, waiting for the benefit, while those that are going to lose out are loudest in resisting reforms and even recruiting the beneficiaries to join in fighting. So you must make up your mind that this is worth doing and just get on with it and hope that posterity will join you right. The labor unions thought they could browbeat us into retaining unqualified teachers, but they discovered that there was no public support for their position. Their strike action collapsed because the parents in Kaduna State rejected the union notion that the children of the poor deserve unqualified teachers. We also found that all the union leaders had their children in private schools, so they had no stake in seeing improvement in the quality of teachers in public schools. Despite this public revolt to their claims, several trade unionists and their political allies are still threatening us with electoral consequences from 2019. They said that Kai Defayeli lost in equity because he attempted to test teachers. We have tested them, we have fired them, and by both threats we are going to get elected. But we know that the people of Kaduna State did not elect us to maintain their practices and people that has held the state back for 16 years. Elections are for the people to decide, and we trust that the people of Kaduna State will make the best government for themselves and their children. Permit me to close, Your Excellency, the Pro Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, by restating our governance mission. Because some of my colleagues say, why are you doing this? Why do you wait till your second time? Are you a suicide bomber or something? But I think it's important that I make this point. Because for me, this is why we are here. This is why we're in office. This is why we're elected. This is why the APC, a party formed from the scratch, was able to change a government that has been in power for 16 years with all the money, the control of security resources and so on. The power of the things for change. And if we don't recognize as APC why we are here, and we forget and join that other party's mentality, the people will give us a bad hand. So I want to close by the statement of governance mission. Our primary purpose in governance is to create equal opportunity and to give every child in Kaduna State the best prospects through decent education. It is to provide employment opportunities for our young people alongside instituting a vibrant economy regulated by a competent public service. It is to prevent pregnancy from being a death sentence for mother and child, and to empower our people to be sufficiently knowledgeable and confident enough to maximize their talents. Governance must empower people, not deepen dependence or surrender unnecessary policies just because they entrenched the entitled elite of voting. This is why we are here. And I've said this before and I'll say it again. We are ready to pack our bags and baggage and leave office the day we are able to do what is right. We'll leave office. We'll not even wait for election. If I am not able to do what I believe to be right in the interest of the people of Kaduna State, I'll just pass my bus and say, allow the deputy governor to take over, or to get any of the to take over. So thank you for listening and your questions.